welcome everybody. This is our November meetup. We are here thanks to Sun Microsystems, our wonderful host. This meetup is graciously sponsored by VORC, the enterprise framework for PHP. The website for that is www.vork.us. That's vork.us. And I'd like to introduce our very wonderful speaker, Dwight Merriman, who is the CEO of 10gen, the parent company to MongoDB. He's also the co-founder of DoubleClick, co-founder of ShopWiki, co-founder of Panther, the CDN, and a few more, and Guild Group, and a whole bunch more. And without further ado, Dwight.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Hi, everybody. I'm Dwight. So today I'm going to talk about MongoDB, which is a new database, open source database. The way I look at the database space, I think there's some changes that are happening and some segmentation is occurring. I think one size fits all is not going to be the model that it was at one time. You know, 10, 20 years ago, I know I would take a relational database and just use it for everything. And whether it was OLAP or, in my case it was ROLAP, or other problems, and it was just generally that's the way to solve the problem. You know, the way computer architectures are changing and the things like horizontal scalability are becoming more important, I think it makes sense for the technologies to specialize a bit. And for us to just see some new technologies. Relational is great, but it's a 40-year-old concept, the relational data model, which is amazing, actually, that it's lasted as a technology that long. And still vibrant, actually, and will continue to be so. But I think there's some other interesting things that can be done, too. Now, this slide shows a few of those. So we've got the classic RDMS base. You know, in addition, I think another significant new database segment is what I'm calling next generation OLAP, which would be things like Vertica, Astrodata, Greenplum, Netezza maybe. So people in doing BI stuff, data warehousing, data mining, data mart type applications or systems. I think there's some new tools there which are very interesting and worth looking at. So that's more on the OLAP side, which is a bit of a specialization out of the traditional database space. In addition, though, we're seeing another space that's starting to form, which is a little newer than this OLAP space, which is these non-relational data stores and databases, which are really more about operational data, things you're accessing and updating in real time. And this is what people are calling NoSQL in many cases. So this was not my name for it, but it seems to be the standard name now for the category. So what does that really mean when someone says NoSQL? Because that's sort of like saying what it's not. It's really scalable, non-relational, next-generation operational data stores and databases is how I'm defining it, right? So I would not put Vertica in this bucket. I would say that's a separate space. That's that next-generation OLAP space. So this is the space that MongoDB operates in. Most of the products in this space are open source, which is interesting, because in the OLAP space, I'd say the majority of the solutions are closed source. So it's fascinating how one space is like 90%. Kind of enterprise software in one space is sort of 90% open source. It's probably in part because this technology, a lot of the early adopters seem to be web developers, people doing web infrastructure. You know, my background was a DoubleClick building Dart, and what we built here is to some degree what I wanted at DoubleClick as a database, what I wish we had. You know, we used Oracle a lot at DoubleClick for storing, advertisers, sites, orders, ad, metadata, all of this stuff, and aggregate report statistics. We had large Oracle databases. But one thing we didn't do, of course, was we didn't hit Oracle in real time and we're serving an ad, which is 20 billion times a day. So we thought that would be a bad idea. So we didn't do it. We ended up building a proprietary key value store there, which we used, which could run across multiple machines and serve our purposes for the lighter weight, but very high frequency read and write data we use for ad serving. So part of the idea in this space is let's have some tools that, maybe from a, in some ways are lighter weight so that we can get the performance and horizontal scalability we want. We'll keep the features that we can and be rich there. So one of the key features of these NoSQL style products is horizontal scalability. So I'd like to talk a little bit about that. So with traditional relational database like Oracle, you know, vertical scaling is the model. And if you look at something like Amazon's new relational data store service, which is based on MySQL, when they announced that, they also announced larger Amazon EC2 instances. You can now get 32 and 64 gig RAM EC2 instances. And that's very interesting that those came out at the same time, because that gives you a path to scalability a bit for MySQL at Amazon with their relational data store service. So that makes perfect sense. I think they did exactly the right thing there, which is to say, gee, the way we scale MySQL is vertically, and we'll provide solutions for that, and it's all good. And of course, Amazon also has other solutions that scale horizontally, like S3, so they're not averse to that. But it's sort of, for this particular technology, they felt that was the right solution. In this space, what we're trying to do is do some different technologies and say, let's do a database that scales horizontally, even if we need to do some things differently to achieve that goal. So what's really different in these NoSQL products is there are no joins, and they have light transactional semantics. And across the board, you know, there's probably about 10 significant open source NoSQL projects, and we'll get into them in a little bit, but they all have these characteristics, pretty much as far as I know. So distributed joins is a very hard problem if you don't make any assumptions about the schema. So the idea here is to say, okay, we're not gonna do joins, so we won't have that problem with scaling horizontally across the distributed system. And then in addition, complex transactions, if you want to distribute transactions, that's hard to distribute too, especially if you want to keep performance and throughput really high. You can do distributed transactions, but it's sort of a question of speed and throughput and how much hardware am I throwing at it, etc. So the idea here in the space is let's throw out these two things, which are big things to throw out, obviously, and then we're going to get into things that in theory should be very easy to scale horizontally, and that's what the whole space is doing. So if you need these things, and you will need these for certain use cases, of course, you're going to still use relational database. But it turns out that there's a large number of use cases in the real world where this actually works. So another thing that comes up with these systems is there's generally some thought given to how do we deal with multi-data center, and how do we scale out that way, how do we deal with geographic distribution, how do we deal with this network problems in a single data center. If we have a database that consists of 1,000 nodes, you know, there could be network problems inside the cluster. So one thing that people have talked a lot about in the NoSQL space is the CAP theorem, which may be familiar with, but it's a computer science theorem, where there's a proof that says that the CAP, which, you know, C is consistency, A is availability, and P is tolerance to network partitions. It basically says you can't have all three. Pick any two. So we there's actually a proof that says you just can't do it. So we have to choose. We can't have our cake and eat it too. So you know, the traditional approach with databases is consistency, consistency, consistency. But we have this proof here that says, well, if you want that, you're going to be down some. It's inevitable. So that's really what that comes from. So there are different approaches in the space, but there's sort of cognizance of this. So Amazon, when they built their internal distributed database data store, key value data store called Dynamo, they said, well, we care more about availability and tolerance network partitions, because we want to distribute this across data centers, than we do about consistency. We have some use cases where that's more important, that you see something rather than that it's the latest, greatest thing. So what Amazon does is they use an eventually consistent model for Amazon Dynamo, which says you may see stale old data, but eventually it will be consistent, which is actually a pretty weak guarantee. As time approaches infinity, it's consistent, is a guarantee. But in reality, it's often consistent, so it's really when bad things are happening with servers and networks that you can get into that kind of a state in general. But so they're on this sort of availability side of this triangle, but there are other solutions in the space, and MongoDB fits in there, which are more on the conventional consistency side of the space. I would also put Google Bigtable down here based on my reading of the Bigtable white paper, There's a white paper from Amazon and Dynamo and from Google on Bigtable. So they're white papers. They don't provide comprehensive information on these solutions, but what I can draw from them is this one putting it here. I'm also putting Paxos on the bottom here. So Paxos is an algorithm or a protocol for maintaining consistent shared information or state among multiple distributed servers. And Paxos actually, it always stays consistent, if I recall correctly, but it may be unavailable, right, in the case of things like the network partition. So it's possible to be on either side. And you'll hear people talk about eventual consistency and availability and so forth, but sort of one of the takeaways from here is it doesn't have to be that. We can kind of choose based on the problem what the right solution is. And folks like Google have chose the other side of the triangle. And there's hybrid approaches too. For example, and my understanding is that Google, while they use Paxos for keeping track of some metadata via their Chubby Lock service for where things are located, they also use asynchronous replication. Because it's just like we might use with MySQL, master-slave replication is asynchronous, so that's sort of an eventually consistent model where the slave is eventually consistent, and it's always going to lag at least milliseconds because it's asynchronous, not synchronous replication. So even things on this bottom edge probably using things like that, which are not perfectly consistent. So you really mix techniques a little bit and use different solutions. So more on scaling out. So how do we distribute the data? There's two main approaches I'm seeing out there. The first one's consistent hashing. So consistent hashing is this ring up here in the picture where you basically randomly allocate nodes in your cluster to points on this ring. You also then hash your data by primary key to a point on the ring. And then the rule is to find the data on the server that's closest on the ring to the data point you hash to. Now, this has some nice properties, which is if the server goes down, there are other servers which are slightly further away. Those are the next places to look. And if we want to add servers, we just stick them on the ring, and we've added them. You do then have a bunch of things to figure out, such as, I was added to the ring, but the data was there before I arrived, and so forth, that you have to figure out. And that's what, for example, Amazon did with Dynamo. They had an approach for that. But that's the basic concept there. You can also do things like when I put a server or a node on the ring, I could actually put it on the ring maybe in five places, and now you get a little more granularity of how things spread out. So we do things like that. That works pretty well with key value data stores. There's another approach which I'm calling range chunking, which is what MongoDB is charting and also what Google Bigtable does. With MongoDB, at least from what I can get from the Bigtable white paper, it does something quite similar because we thought it made sense. Which is, as we see in this little table here, so if we have a collection called users, you can think of it as a table. We have a min key and an max key for a range, and basically values in that range are on a particular shard then. So this is how Bigtable works. Bigtable, I forget, they call these tablets maybe. We call them chunks, these pieces of data from here to here. So what we do with a system like this is basically if we keep adding a lot of data in this range, that chunk will get really large. It'll then split into two chunks, and we might merge to a chunk to a different server. So that's how Google, that's how Bigtable works, that's how MongoDB works with its partitioning. The nice property of a system like this is the chunking or the partitioning is order preserving partitioning. So if we need some data from a range query, that are in a small range, but there are adjacent values, those will tend to be on one server. So we don't have to go hit the whole cluster to get a range of values. So like let's say you had data on stock prices for the last 10 years and be partitioned it by time, right? So if I wanted all the data for the day, that might be on one server or a small number of servers at least. So that's the idea there. One other sort of query model that is scaling out that we think is important is what I call scatter-gather. So The one thing about both of these approaches is that we're kind of partitioning on primary key. So if your query involves a primary key, we can usually find the right servers and be really efficient with it. But if it doesn't, the question is, well, what do we do then? Do we just say it can't do it? There is a possible solution, although there's some cost to it, which is to say, let's query everyone. So let's ask every shard, send the query to every shard, collect back the results, and return them to the user. So that's what I'm calling scatter-gather. So MongoDB, you can do both approaches, where if you do a query with using the shard key, it'll only hit the relevant servers. But if you do a query that doesn't involve a shard key, we can still run it, but we'll shoot it out to every shard and collect back the results for you. If you have a cluster with, say, a dozen shards, my experience is that works very well, right? Send off a request to 12 machines, get back a little data from 12 machines, return it, that's fine. If you have a cluster with 1,000 shards, it's probably not as good idea to send query to 1,000 machines to get back the results. Although, actually, Facebook does that with their infrastructure using memcached key, where they will actually query a tremendous number of memcached key nodes to render a page. But they did tons and tons of optimization on it, and using key and all these other things, and ran into various issues with switches, so it's generally not where you want to go unless you have a problem that is really, really hard to partition. So shifting subjects a little, so that's a little bit on horizontal scalability. Let's talk a little bit about data models. So we're not doing joins, so we don't have a relational data model, right? We have no choice. So the question then is, what should the data model be? And as we shift to new data models, I think that brings up a really big opportunity, which is to say, well, if we're going to use a different data model, if we choose it carefully, we can probably get some neat features out of it, right? So the question is, with these NoSQL solutions, what is your data model? Well, the answer is right now it varies because this space is very young, right? The trend towards using this product really started this spring. I would say, you know, this time last year, you know, we were coding away on MongoDB and we thought this was a great idea, but there was very little usage of our solution or others. Now it's a lot in the web space, actually, starting to get there. Data models vary, there's more than three, but I think there's three main buckets. The first is just key value, primary key of the block, right? So get, put, delete on primary key, that's all you get. It's a great example there of memcached key. Amazon Dynamo, that's the model too. Amazon said, you know what, we have a bunch of data storage problems where if I can just get and put on primary key and it's persistent store, I can solve that problem. And yeah, I also have a bunch of other problems where I can't, but at least there I can solve it, and that's what Dynamo does. The next bucket on data models is this column-oriented or tabular data models. So this is what Bigtable does. This is really the Bigtable data model. So Bigtable has these tables, which are really more like a multi-dimensional table, you know, more than two dimensions, and there's some other neat features in terms of being able to put in data without predefining columns in some cases on some of these. So a little more flexible, perhaps, in a conventional relation, but I don't have joins. So I think the advantage of this approach is that it feels familiar to a developer. You say, you know, it's not a relational database, but you can still put data in tables. They say, oh, okay, I get that, right? But I feel like this is really a bridging step, because if we're not going to have the power of relational, if we're not going to have joins, if we're not going to have a formal relational calculus underlying all the technology we're building, we've lost a lot. And what did we keep? We kept the impedance mismatch with object-oriented programming languages. So we kind of lost the most powerful feature and kept one of the cons in a way, although we do keep familiarity. So I feel like this data model is a bridging function. Of course, that's my opinion. There's a bunch of folks working out there on all these projects who would say, no, you're crazy, Dwight. This is a great thing. But that's how I think of the space. So what we did with Mongo is we said, you know what, if we're going to go away from relational, let's try to do something that's easy to work with from the languages we use today, and most of which are object-oriented. And that's where we get to what we call document-oriented databases. So by document, think XML document, right? A document with some structure, a document with some nesting. It could be fairly rich. Now, we're not doing XML, actually. The concept behind our data store here is JSON. So JavaScript object notation, which is a lot like XML, but much easier to read for a developer, and has a few neat features that we don't need in XML, like a few more data types, like a numeric data type. It's not everything's not a string, and so forth. So we find that JSON is a very natural format to map to from objects and programs. Yet we like it because it's not tied to a particular programming language. So we have a language-independent standard. We have an RFC, JSON RFC, for storing this data that is an object-like syntax that's relatively straightforward to map to from any object-oriented programming language. And so that's very nice. But it's different than the object databases from the late 80s, which are still around, of course. But it's a very different philosophy, I think. These objects are, you know, we're not saying, you know, take the graph of objects in your program and just make it all persistent and it's all magic and everything's transparent. We're not saying that at all. We're saying you still do schema design. We declare some collections. We very carefully design what's going to be in these documents. And oh, by the way, it will be pretty easy to get that data in and out of an object-oriented program. But you know, we're not storing methods. We're not storing class hierarchies. That's all about your program. That's not about the database. We want the data in the database to be language independent, because we all know that in the real world, you end up using multiple programming languages in the company, and that programming languages change over time. You're going to have data from 4 years ago when you decide to switch to the next latest greatest programming language. So that is the philosophy there. So in terms of MongoDB, the philosophy is let's build something as rich in functionality as we can without losing horizontal scalability, without losing very good performance characteristics. We think there's a knee in this curve, which is implicit on the slide. All right. So, you know, we think, you know, where I put the MongoDB dot, it's you can't go further or you're going to drop down. And, you know, RDBMS, I think, is an incredibly powerful tool that's super rich in features and functionality, right? So that's a good thing. But on the other hand, there's a cost to that. You know, if you want to be able to do complex transactions and they're atomic and serializable, there's a cost to that. If you want to be able to do transactions that are larger than RAM, for example, which you can do in a relational database, that has big implications on your architecture of the database. And it's going to do some things where if you just wanted to update one row, it's going to slow things down probably. So that's the philosophy here is, you know, there are these products out there like Project Voldemort, which is in the Amazon Dynamo clone, which is a key value store, you know, where this functionality is very simple. And that leads to an elegant, simple solution that's very scalable, that solves a certain class of problems. So we're saying, you know, we think we can push further to the right before we hit the knee in the curve. You know, we think we can do, you know, ad hoc queries on secondary keys and secondary indexes and sorting and these kind of things. You know, and we are leaving out a couple things, but they're the things I mentioned previously. You know, MongoDB, it's being used now in production by a lot of companies, and you know, the early adopters in the space are really websites so far, although I think the technology will be applicable in almost all organizations, although not for all use cases, right? You got to look at the particular use case. It's not one size fits all. You know, it's great to see the adoption, especially as this stuff is really new. So I think next year it's going to be, you know, thousands of websites, and also there's some other companies who are using it who are not websites per se. So to take a specific example, Business Insider, which is actually a company I was angel investor in, basically, they're using MongoDB. So they were a very early adopter. They were using it actually in 2008. But the site's written in PHP, but 100% of the data at the site is stored in MongoDB. So nothing is stored straight in the file system, and nothing is stored in a relational database at the site. Works great, I think. So you should check the site out if you're not, especially Silicon Alley Insider is a great, cool site to look at from a New York perspective. You know, I have this quote here from Ian, who's CTO at Business Insider. We're using Lamp, Linux, Apache, MongoDB, and PHP. So all of the blog posts, text in the site, all of the comments in the site, all of the real-time performance counters that they generate on the back end for internal admin use are on the site or in MongoDB, and all the images for the blog post, like this farmer image, is actually stored in the database. So that's how they're using it, and they're quite happy, actually. There's a blog post on, actually I got the URL here, on Business Insider on how to use it. You might want to check that later if that sounds interesting to you. So what does this data actually look like? So let's take a real example. And this is a little bit simplified, but you know what? So Business Insider is basically a blog. It's Huffington Post for business. So what are they actually storing in their Mongo database? So in MongoDB, we have this concept of collection. So it's a collection of JSON objects. And you can have any number of collections you want. You can also have separate databases, but within the database, there are collections. Within collections, there are JSON objects. So they have lots of collections, but their primary collection, the key collection of the whole database, is the blog post collection. So the objects in this collection look sort of like this. You know, we have a blog post title, we have some text, the text body of the post, we have an author field, you know, the date we posted it, which we use in a blog, you know, typically sort of from newest to oldest in terms of the information. We have tags, right, in the blog. So, and we also have the comments here. So we've embedded the data from the user comments right in the blog post object itself. And we've done this for several reasons, but one reason is we don't have any joins, right? So what if I want to do a join between the blog post and the comments? Well, the way you can do it. So the way you do it is client side, and there's an extra client server turnaround, and sometimes that's fine, but it's not if you need to do thousands of turnarounds, even if the database is 1 millisecond away on the network. But if you need to do 5 turnarounds, it's okay, right? So there is a model for reference traversal, but it involves a re-query back to the server. So there's other reasons to embed in the comments, which is the database then provides us some tools to manipulate those things easily. And in addition, it yields great performance. So because we have all the data about this blog post, including the tags and all the comments, in one contiguous chunk of data on disk, and one contiguous thing in RAM. So, you know, if we store this in the relational database and we normalize this, you know, I've got, you know, 3 comments and 2 tag fields and the blog post itself. I've probably got at least 6 rows here and 3 tables for this one blog post, and there could be 100 comments too. And more tags and more other things. So I can get this all on one quick operation. You know, in a relational database, even if everything's in the page cache and RAM, it's still going to do the join every time to put these 6 things together. So there's going to be some more computation. So, you know, one reason these solutions can be fast is not because we're smarter than anyone else. It's just because the problem is suddenly easier for us in certain cases. So let's take an example here of how we might do a query. So MongoDB is a lot like something like MySQL in terms of how you program to it. So for each programming language, there's a client driver connected to the database, a client server over a TCP socket. There's a protocol that's kind of proprietary to MongoDB for sending these objects over the network. And each language, the query language for MongoDB, we do not use SQL. Instead, we generally represent queries as JSON objects, which gives us a query language, if you will, that's language independent. But then beyond that, there's a driver API that will vary by language. So the examples in this presentation are in JavaScript. So MongoDB comes with an administrative shell, which is JavaScript-based. It's based on SpiderMonkey, where just you either read eval print loop, and you can go in there and manipulate the database just like you would from a MySQL command line administrative tool. And instead of doing SQL, we do JavaScript statements like this one, right? So here's an example. So DB is our database connection object. Post is our collection name. So find, we're going to do a query. So we're doing a query, then this part here, tags, colon, economy, and braces is a JSON object. This is our query. So this is saying select star from post where tags equals economy. And then we have this order by timestamp descending limit 10. So we can do a fairly rich operation here. This isn't just the, you know, key value store. You know, the way you talk to this is different. So it looks a little different at first, but actually if you used it for 4 hours, you would say, okay, I got it, and this is really easy to use, et cetera, et cetera. So we find that developers really like using it. There's one other thing to note here, so is that this tags colon economy, we're saying where tags equals economy, tags was an array. So if this was something else like author, it would just tax column economy would mean author equals John Smith would be the expression. Here, because tax is an array, it means where economy is a member of the tax array. So that's a fairly powerful operation. But because we have these richer objects, we need some operations that let us kind of reach into these objects. So I can reach into arrays, I can reach into nested objects. Here's some more examples. Here's how I create an index in MongoDB. So I can create an index on tags or on timestamp, or I'll create a compound index here, tags ascending, timestamp ascending. So if I'm doing queries like this, where, actually like this query where I'm looking for a particular tag, and then I want the item sorted by timestamp ascending, a compound index could be quite useful for that. So very much, I can do the same thing probably in a relational database. A lot of those concepts still apply in MongoDB. We have a query optimizer, it picks a query plan, it runs that query plan. So in some ways, it's conventional. In addition, we declare indexes, which is just like a traditional database, right? These are B-tree indexes. The one difference is on something like timestamp here is that the type of this field is not predefined. So it's more like a weakly typed programming language, and it's like JSON, which is weakly typed, where different documents or objects can have different fields, and different documents could have the same field but with different data types, right? And another document, theoretically, timestamp could be an integer. Now, typically, that's not the way you're going to write code, right? In most cases, in fact, let's take the Business Insider case, and specifically, there's thousands of blog posts in your post collection. Every single one of them has a TS field, and every single one of those has a date data type to that field. But you have the flexibility. I could go modify a blog post and add a new field that's not in any of the other posts, save it back to the collection, and the database doesn't care even though the other fields have it. So there's no upfront column definition, there's no upfront definition of types for these fields. So that's where the term schemaless comes from, which is a slight misnomer because there is some structured schema to the system. Collections are there. As soon as you save an item to a collection, it creates it, so creation is implicit. We're explicitly declaring indexes, and then the fields are there, but it's only what you stick in there. So the other note here is when we create the index, we're actually doing the function is called ensure index. And what we typically do here is we make this a very lightweight operation. So if you're calling ensure index all over the place in your code, it's saying, I assume there's an index on tags, and if there isn't one, there needs to be one, and it'll create it if it's not there. But that's a very cheap operation, and there's no client-server turnaround on it. So you can do this all over the place in your code, and the philosophy there is to really get out of having scripts to define the schema up front, right? And there's pros and cons to this, of course. You can make arguments about data integrity and so forth, but we're not trying to solve all problems, just half of all problems, let's say. And so if you have problems where you need to be nimble, you want to use, maybe you were using a weakly type programming language like Ruby, Python, and PHP anyway, or Erlang, and you want to do agile development and be fast to do things, this fits really well with that. In addition, I can use it from strongly typed languages. Lots of people using it from Java, people using it from C++, works fine too. That's just a little more synergy with those languages even. So more queries for you. Here's an example of how we do a query where a timestamp is greater than some value. So we have some special operators that we put a dollar sign in front of. So dollar sign is a reserved character in the field names of our JSON in MongoDB. Here's another example where author is in one of these values. So this is like the in operator in SQL. And then this final one here is a regular expression. This is like the like operator in SQL. Okay, so that's kind of the equivalent here. So once again, trying to be rich in terms of query expressiveness. There are some queries actually at this stage of MongoDB and current release that are hard to do involving things like OR and non-expressions. Although there is an escape mechanism, which is you can execute JavaScript server-side on server. So it's possible when you do a query to give a JavaScript expression to be evaluated at the server, which is then you can do anything, of course, because you've got a full Turing machine then in terms of your expression evaluation. So it's very flexible. But that's a little bit slower than this form, which is extremely fast in terms of evaluation. Keep going. One more query here. So one other note with these documents is we're nesting. We can nest objects. So here we have address as a nested object here, right? within our user object, let's say. So, but database understands this, these fields in here can reach into these objects. So here I'm looking for finding users where address.state equals New York, okay? So we use dot notation here to express this. In addition, I could create an index on this, right? I could say, create an index on address.state, and it would do that. So the database can reach into these objects deeply, either into nested arrays or objects or combinations, which is really where a lot of the power comes from when you use it. So this is not just the key value store where I can store JSON, but I'm only getting into the primary key, because some other solutions in the space do that. This is, you know, there's some richness here, and this sort of paradigm of design pattern of having richer style objects with embedding comes into play a lot when people really use it in production. One other key feature of the product, I think, is that it does fast updates in place. So there's a couple ways to write databases these days from an architectural standpoint. One is the way MySQL works, which is what I call update in place, and I think Oracle works this way too, but maybe somebody can correct me later, because I'm no expert on these things. But if you do an update where in MySQL or Oracle, I think it will actually update an existing record potentially, and of course update all the relevant, we can do undo logs. In place, there's another approach, which is to do an MVCC architecture, which is multi-version concurrency control, I think. And basically what that means is that every time we do any operation, even if it's an update, we write a new version out, and we don't update the old copy. We never update the old copy. We just update it. We write a new version. It's probably got a version number or ordinal in there or something like that. And the MVCC model is what Postgres does. That has some very neat properties in terms of things like snapshotting that are really powerful, right? So every time I do an update, I write a new version, the old version's still there. So if somebody started a query before my operation began, you know, the database can just remember the time that started and ignore my newer version and turn them to the old version so they can get a very consistent snapshot of the database even though other people are doing writes concurrently. So MVCC has a lot of advantages in this. In Postgres, you have that. But update in place has advantages too, and one of those advantages is it's fast. And in particular, it's fast for updates. So in MongoDB is update in place, but it's also, even among databases with that architecture, it's fast in that category for a couple of reasons. And the big reason is that the data storage engine on MongoDB is using memory map files to manipulate the data. So when you do an update, what we're doing, you know, here we have an update, we're saying update where underscore ID equals some value, which is not specified here, and then the operation is increment y by 2. So what the database will then do is it'll find this object with this ID using an index, and then it'll find the y field in that object, and it'll add 2 to that value using a pointer in RAM, in the memory map file, which is a fast operation. So you can imagine doing that thousands of times per second, and then the virtual memory manager of the operating system will flush these pages to disk lazily. So, you know, I could update this, I could do 1,000 increments in the next second of this one object, and then at some point in the next couple, 2 seconds, let's say, the operating system will write it to disk, but it won't do 1,000 writes to disk. So there's some durability trade-off there, right? But, you know, we're not a highly transactional system anyway, so you probably pick the problem for which that trade-off is good. You're saying, I want speed, and yeah, if you lose 2 seconds of data, I can live with that. So that's the general idea. In addition here, we could have done an upsert. So that would mean update the object where ID is this, increment y by 2, and if it wasn't there, let's add the object. So I can send this to the server, not wait for a response, and go do something else. And it will either insert it or update it. That can be really useful for certain use cases, such as doing real-time performance counters. So one thing MongoDB is great at is real-time performance counters for real-time analytics. You know, it's not great at OLAP or kind of non-real-time analytics where you're loading data every night and you're just going to do, you know, lots of SQL group by queries and such. You can do that stuff, but it's not necessarily better than the existing solutions. Solutions are even as good in some cases. But here we're doing real-time performance counters, hitting updating many, many, many times a second, and then we'll see real-time snapshot of the state. It's really good at that use case. Checking the time here. I don't want to bore you guys to death. So another example, just from a schema design standpoint, here's one where we've got a student object. We have some embedded, embedded address object in it, right? Where, you know, in relational, we would normalize that now. I also have scores within the student object, because it's sort of a contained relationship anyway. And I've got an array of score objects. But then I do have some references to external courses where, you know, presumably if you did this, it's because there's a lot of other information around courses over there, or the name might change. But that is a reference. So if I wanted, if I was using this in a real product, what I would do is I can get all the information about the student over here, but if I needed a course name, I would have to do another client server turnaround to the database to get that course name. Another design pattern, though, would be, you know, maybe I just load all the courses up front when my program starts because there's only 200 courses. You know, so that would be a common way to approach it, too. So on sharding, you know, how to, so we talked a little bit about scaling out horizontally before. How does it work specifically with MongoDB? So there's this MongoDB daemon, which is kind of like MySQLD, which is the core database process. You want to run on one server with no replication or anything, you just start that and you're done. And we're up and running, you connect to it and go at it. But if we want to set up a complex cluster with many, many machines, it might look something more like this, where we have one or more MongoDBs per shard, for each shard storing separate partitions of data. Now, we may have multiple when we're doing replication for failure or redundancy. So we use replication as our path to data failover and safety. We use sharding as our path to scalability. In addition, the metadata of the system is also stored in Mongo, and these are in config server instances. And then we have another process called Mongo S for sharding, which really is the database router or coordinator of everything. So the client can connect to a single point here, Mongo S, and get a single logical view of an entire database cluster. Mongo S will then take care of all coordination for that client. Likewise, the client could have connected over the same protocol to a single node MongoD instance if your database is just on a server. So that's sort of how the process is laid out. And this is how you might actually set it up on physical servers, right? So those were processes. And, you know, the config server is a pretty lightweight process. There's not that much data metadata because each chunk can be pretty large. It can be, for example, 100 megabytes per chunk of data. We can just throw them on some existing machines. I just want to spread it out among more than one machine because I don't want the cluster to be down if I lose a single machine. And likewise, I can run the Mongo S's anywhere I want. The Mongo S's have no persistent state, so you can run them anywhere. They just get data metadata. They gotta get data metadata up front from the config servers. They will get that on demand as they need it and cache it in RAM. In fact, I could run the Mongo S on the app server machine if I wanted to. That would work just fine. It would be a very good choice, actually, in some cases. So states of the product. You know, all of the solutions in this space are very early stage. I think MongoDB is at least as far along as any of them, although it varies in terms of maturity and different features. I think it's not as mature on auto sharding as some of the other solutions where that was sort of the whole purpose of the project from day one and do nothing else. Yet it will be more mature on other dimensions. So the core MongoDB server is, there's a full production 1.0 plus release out right now. It's very stable. In addition, replication is built into that, so full production. The other sharding module is in alpha. You can go try it tonight if you want, but there'll be a beta and a production release over the next few months sequentially. In addition, there's a new MapReduce feature, which works in both sharded and uncharted environments, which is an alpha, which is usable now. So the alpha just sort of signifies how far along it is, but it's, you can use it today. You can go download it, try it. Everything's there. There's pre-built binaries for virtually most operating systems, including Linux, OS X, Solaris, Windows. And that's DAX, so I assume, if you want, we can do some questions.
Yes, yes. The question I have is, when you do an update, is there any locking going on?
Yeah.
In terms of concurrency and stuff?
Yeah, I should have covered that. So the question is around concurrency and consistency. So as we said at the beginning, one, these systems don't have heavy transactional semantics. But we do have a little bit. So you can do atomicity at the single document level, right? So if I want to, you know, debit some fields and credit some fields in a single document atomically, I can do that. In a lot of use cases, you need that, but in a lot of use cases, that's sufficient. In fact, it can be particularly sufficient because our documents can be relatively rich, right? I could have a lot of nesting in my object, and I can manipulate all of that atomically. But if I need to do a big operation across many, many documents, that would be non-atomic generally. So I either have to find a way to do that from a programmer standpoint, or I would choose a different tool.
Can you speak a little bit about character encoding and if there's restrictions on the key names in the JSON documents, if there are JavaScript namespaces?
Yeah, character encoding. So actually some of the sorting, UTF-8 style sorting, is still not there yet. It's sort of binary sort order. But you can store any UTF in the system just fine on the value side. On the key side, the keys are actually UTF-8 too. But there are certain reserved characters. So like the dot is reserved because of the dot notation we saw before. And general dollar sign is reserved because of that before. So sometimes in keys, if your key can be anything, you probably want to have an escaping technique to use for them and unescaping.
I believe you could change that, right? So that you could change the dollar sign to something else.
Okay, it's possible that.
Maybe it's only in the PHP extension.
I bet that's the case. I bet it's on the PHP driver or something like that.
PHP, you could use something else instead.
Right, that makes sense because it's dollar sign such an important character in PHP.
Right.
Right, but you probably know more about the PHP driver than I do, actually.
On the back.
Okay.
There are like two ways to group, you know, like documents in MongoDB. One is using MapReduce, and another is using the traditional group by query, something like SQL. My question is that, what do you recommend for, you know, like in certain scenarios, like where do you recommend using MapReduce and where do you recommend using GroupBy? Because like for the current project, like I've been using, you know, like a bunch of MapReduce scripts. They are like acting as, you know, like bad jobs, and some are like needs to be done on demand. I mean, the data needs to be displayed on demand. So.
Right. There's two facilities for aggregation in MongoDB. There's a group command where you can actually do some grouping that's a little bit like SQL group by. In addition, there's a full sort of MapReduce system too, where you give it map and reduce functions that are actually written in JavaScript, and then it'll run those server side and all the different servers and do the reduction. So when do you use what? It's a good question. You know, we built both mechanisms because we thought we needed both, and
yeah,
the group.
GroupBy has some, you know, like I think it can have more than 15,000 keys.
Yeah, group has some limitations. So I think our fully generalized solution is MapReduce, which is very scalable to any size data set. Group has a limit on how much data you can get back. So if you know you're getting back a relatively small amount of data in real time, I would use group. But there's no hard and fast rule of thumb. You know, we're kind of seeing what makes sense as people use it, and we want feedback as you use it. And, you know, let us know if say, well, this is really dumb, or I prefer this than that, and we'll take the roadmap in the right direction.
Do you have any RESTful APIs like to avoid any mid-layer where JavaScript will call directly to the MongoDB?
Right, so the question is, do we have a REST interface? So we have a REST interface, but it's somewhat alpha just because it hasn't been used very heavily, but there is one. In general, most users of MongoDB are not using it. They're using the native client drivers for their particular language. I think REST is pretty popular with JavaScript folks, right? So that would be a place where it makes a lot of sense. And you can do it, but it's not been used that heavily in Mongo compared to other things like CouchDB, where people use REST. That's the fundamental way you access the database. I think we do need and want to make the REST interface more mature. And two, we do like having native client drivers, though, just like something like MySQL, because it gives very good performance. You know, rather than talking to the database over HTTP and JSON, we're doing it over a proprietary protocol. Everything's kind of binary format going over the wire. We've optimized quite a bit. So we like that for performance reasons.
All the way in the back.
Have you guys done any kind of benchmarking? I mean, all this sounds really interesting, especially from a turning inside out perspective, but in the end, we're looking at the same primitive operations in terms of I have some data that I want to query against a big pile of data. I mean, certain things in a certain amount of time, and so the trade-off of whether to do something maybe MySQL versus Mongo will really hinge on convenience of development versus real performance gains,
etc.
So do you have any more
kind of
metrics that speak to, well, if you're willing to make these trade-offs, you can get these gains?
Right. Wait, did everyone hear the question
up front?
Okay.
So the question is generally about performance and benchmarking versus a traditional database. So, first I'll say that I think there are a lot of reasons to use the product independent of performance. One is just horizontal scalability if you need to be able to scale beyond one server. Another is that developers actually find it's elegant and easy to work with. A lot of developers who are using the product now, a few who have told me, boy, when I have to go back to the way I used to do it, I actually realized that I like this better, just from a programming standpoint, independent of everything else. That's a subjective thing, so that I would try it, and you might like it. So back to performance then. So there are cases where it can be very fast compared to a traditional database because we've taken some stuff out, right? We've denormalized effectively and we're not doing complex transactions, so there's an opportunity to be fast. So there are some problems for which I think you'll get 5 to 10x the performance of a relational database, which is a big gain. I think there's some things you'll find the performance is the same, and there are a few things which I think you'd actually find that will be worse. I think there's some things with aggregation operations where, like, for example, something like MySQL is very clever about only touching the index and never touching the core data file rows, and we're not quite that smart yet just in terms of product evolution where they'll beat us. But in general, it's very fast. So a good example is Business Insider. They're doing multiple queries and updates on every single page view of the site to MongoDB to generate the page dynamically. They wouldn't have done that traditionally with MySQL. They would have used memcached in front of it for almost every operation to have that isolation. Now, they still use memcached because there are a few things they do which are heavyweight queries, like to generate rankings of top posts and so forth that take, maybe take a minute or 30 seconds to generate, so they cache those kind of things. But they find that they can, in many cases, hit the database in real time, and it's fast enough that that works just fine. And you find in practice that, what I find is that you find yourself, you're like, gee, I can write this code in a lot simpler way. I don't have to build my own caching and intelligence in. And every time you cache, then I have to deal with stale data and dirty data and things like that. It adds complexity. So you can do it kind of the simple, naive, brute force way in many cases, and it saves time as a developer. So in part, the answer is your mileage may vary, but there are use cases where you get much, much better performance, we find. There are some benchmarks out there. They're all over the map. I've also seen some people do benchmarks in maybe Ruby or Python, and actually the client becomes the bottleneck then because it's Ruby or Python, and they get a number that they're not impressed with, but the database was running at 10 or 20% CPU for the test, and their client was at 100% CPU. So you will see some stuff out there like that, so beware. But if you do, if you take the Java driver, you can do 20,000 inserts or these queries per second. I've seen some people report 50,000. So it can be quite fast. And remember, sometimes you're getting things divided in multiple rows in a relational database. So we're kind of cheating, if you will, in that we're getting kind of a pre-joined package back in some cases.
On a related note, I'm curious. Instead of aware, you guys use regex on Mongo. So how does that compare performance-wise, regex versus like a MySQL aware statement?
Right, so the question is, we use regular expressions is an option to be used in queries, which is analogous to the like command in SQL. And what we do is actually, the example I had earlier had a caret at the beginning of it, which was if you do a regular expression that starts with a caret, we then know that we're looking for a prefix, and the query optimizer then knows it can use an index. Just like in MySQL, if you do a like statement with a percent at the end of the word, it'll do the same thing. So there is some intelligence on the regular expressions with query optimization.
So it's comparable.
It's comparable there, yeah. I think you will find cases where the query optimizer is not smarter than this thing, yeah. But in general, I think it does a pretty good job.
How does it compare to
CouchDB? So CouchDB is another NoSQL database. It's also document-oriented and JSON-oriented like MongoDB, so in some ways it's one of the more similar ones in the space. There is a document on the MongoDB website which outlines a lot of differences, so you might want to look that up later. But I'll give you, they're actually, besides the fact that they're document-oriented and both based on JSON, they're quite different, actually. CouchDB is MVCC architecture, so good at snapshotting, good at versioning, but not as fast at updates. It's native interface is REST to the database, which is nice if you want to use REST and be very kind of Web 2.0-ish. But we philosophically like a conventional approach like MySQL or Oracle, where you have a client driver and an optimized protocol to the server. So what happens is that I think you'll find in many cases that MongoDB is faster, both because it's not MVCC, and also because we have these native drivers over a binary wire protocol that's optimized. And also I think just that performance was a particular focus for us with MongoDB. In C++, and that was an important piece. Couch has some very elegant aspects to it. So it's all the queries in Couch are expressed as MapReduce statements in JavaScript, which basically what happens then is they materialize views based on those MapReduce functions. So that's kind of cool because you can do some neat things with it, and it gives you a very clear and query model. But there's a certain amount of effort to create those queries compared to just an ad hoc query statement. It also, the queries are more predefined than an ad hoc, so when you need to do a more ad hoc style query, I think MongoDB is better. CouchDB is really good at master-master replication, and what happens then is that there are updates on two masters that talk to each other. There's a version reconciliation process. It'll keep both versions, and then you have to write code to pick the winner, and or merge the two versions. So if you have offline, online data synchronization of multiple masters, it works really well, but there's a certain amount of developer work too, once again, to merge those versions in. So if I were writing Lotus Notes, CouchDB would be the perfect tool to be a data store for it, because it's great at this master-master, offline, online replication and versioning. But if I'm writing web infrastructure, if I'm going to do a website and I want an operational data store for my website, I think MongoDB is a much more natural fit for that use case.
In terms of the database administration of the MongoDB, can you speak up in terms of the installation, backups, union, configuration changes, and the object maintenance? Is there a lot of database administration work
involved
by MySQL?
Yeah, database administration. So I think in general there's less database administration. There's still database administration, of course. The philosophy is to make it not administration intensive. You know, I think an example of something that's administration intensive is Oracle, right? So the idea, you know, Michael Stonebreaker, one of his sayings is no knobs. Right, no dials to turn and tune, and I think that's also a cloud computing principle. Right, there's a synergy between these products and cloud computing, and some of the key attributes, you know, horizontal scalability, you know, low configuration and administration. These are tenets of cloud computing, and the general trend things are handing in. So we try to make it lightweight on administration, and you know, you can download and get this thing running, I think, in 5 minutes. So I think it's very easy to install and run. A good example might be setting up master-slave replication. You can definitely do that significantly faster than you would with MySQL. I could set it up in 1 minute. I think there's not a lot of administrative tasks to be done. I mean, but you know, there is, you know, you do have to kind of, you know, back up your data and do things like that. There are tools for doing backups, and there's a web page in the documentation that just talks about different backup strategies. You might want to go check that out later. I think that would be a good thing to look at. There's also an administration section on the website. You could go down to that too. How do you tune queries? Right, so there is an explain plan and a hint statement in MongoDB. So I can do explain and hint, just like I could do in SQL. The syntax is a little different, but I can do those same operations. So there's also a profiler. There's a performance profiler where a system will log in a database how long it takes for every operation to run and some internal statistics on what happened. So if you have something that's slow, you can go in, use the profiler, and look at what the culprit was, and then figure it out from there. You can also look at what's the current operation that's running. You can just kind of snapshot that a few times and say, oh, okay, this is the thing that's taking forever. I'll go optimize that. But tuning is conceptually similar. Now, I think it's a bit easier because we're not doing joins. So the number of possible query plans that our query optimizer is considering is smaller. Right? Because if you have a query with a lot of joins, there could be millions of ways to run the query. Right? We never have millions of ways to do a query, right? Because you know there's only so many indexes to choose from and we're not doing joins. So in some sense, we have an easier problem. And I think because of that, the query optimizer usually does a good job if you created the indexes. Right? Now, if you forgot to create an index and that's a tuning step, you can go create the index. You'd have to do that still. In addition, the query optimizer does something that I think is very neat, which is what we will do is if we have a couple of alternative query plans, we will execute them concurrently when you run the query. And the first one to finish wins. We then stop the operation, we'll return the data, and we'll additionally note in our statistics that this was the fast plan. So it's a very empirical approach, but we run the things concurrently so that you don't get worst case behavior. Right, if we pick wrong. So there's a certain amount of overhead that these things are running at the same time, but the goal is to not have worst case behavior. And I think that's a pretty neat thing that goes on with the product. Yes?
Is there a human technical support for developers? And if there is, how much it costs?
Yeah, so MongoDB is an open source project. TenGen is the company that I work for and help start, which is a commercial company, and all we do is basically commercialization of MongoDB. So what we're currently offering is commercial support for MongoDB. You're gonna see additional products and services over time from TenGen. We just closed our Series B round, raised $3.4 million from Flatbush Capital and Unisquare Ventures. But you can buy commercial support from us today, which is one of the nice things about MongoDB because not all the products in this space have commercializations yet. There's a company who is trying to make this very both open source, community vibrant, but also commercially vibrant for people. You want somebody to call at 3 a.m., you can call us. How much does it cost? About the same as MySQL. There's pricing on the site, on the TenGen site, not the MongoDB site.
Full text search?
Full text search, yeah. I think there's an article either on the site or the blog about full text search, so you might want to look at that later. The feature that lets us look into arrays for a value in a query, in the tags example we saw earlier, it is good for full text search. In fact, if you index on that tags field, it indexes every single value in the array. So there's a technique with MongoDB where you have an array of maybe stemmed words from your document, and it'll index those very easy to query then. But it's that's somewhat low level facility. So there's more full text search functionality than a basic RDBMS would have in many cases, unless they have a special super duper module for that. But there's not a fully generalized Lucene Solr type of system. You know, there's not stemming and ranking type stuff built in yet. But I think there's a good foundation for building something on top of that, either yourself or for somebody else to do a module that sits on top of it. I think a year from now, there'll be some pretty powerful full text search modules on the system. One other note on full text search is I think the use case for MongoDB will be good in the future for full text search is for real-time search, right? Where I want search results, including things that were put in the store 1 minute ago, right? Because a lot of conventional information retrieval engines do batch building of their indexes, of their inverted index, and that's very efficient when you do a batch, but the data is stale then. So that's a common, you know, a lot of people want real-time search. You know, with MongoDB, if you want real-time, it's pretty efficient for that. If you build indexes in batch, like something like Verity would do, that would actually probably be faster, although it's stale then. So the real-time search, full-text search, is the case that's going to be interesting with MongoDB.
I just want to take a quick pause before we can go on to more questions and let everybody know that if you guys already have a PHP environment running, you can be up and running with a framework powered by MongoDB using Vork in about 10 minutes. It's really easy. It's about 3 steps. And you install MongoDB from mongodb.org. You install Vork from vork.us. That's V-O-R-K.us. The instructions are on the website how to get started with Mongo. It's literally a 10-minute procedure. So, next questions.
You mentioned that there's more of an availability trade-off on the cap triangle than other NoSQL databases. Could you elaborate on that a little more?
Yeah, so availability. I think the Amazon Dynamo style solutions say, I want availability more than consistency. The things that are more big table style say, I want consistency more than availability. But they're really, they're somewhat of a hybrid, right? Because they do asynchronous replication generally. So MongoDB is more like Bigtable, which is, I think most people will run a MongoDB database cluster in one data center, and if they have other data centers, they'll have replicas there, which they might either just read from only, but as master slave, or fail over to in the event in an outage situation. So I think the current state of the product is that your primary write copy would be in one data center. I think over time that's going to change and there's going to be a lot of multi-data center support. But the way it works right now, I'd say it's kind of similar to like a Google Bigtable type system where you probably have one data center, replicas in other data centers. The replication works great over a wide area network. You know, I have lots of people using the MongoDB replication over the internet to a second location, which is totally fine because it's asynchronous, so latency doesn't matter. But generally, a cluster that you're both reading and writing to is typically in one location currently. I mean, there are different ways you can do it, though, and we're going to be writing a new article on some different techniques towards multi-data center soon, but it'll probably be a week or so from now. I'll have some new thoughts on that.
Can you speak more about the storage of the documents, and is there the ability to cluster the store based on index?
Right, so clustering by index. So one note on the storage of the documents is this is basically a JSON data store, but we're not literally storing JSON internally. We're storing a binary representation of JSON, which is packed to be really efficient and fast to scan, and we call that BSON, kind of for binary JSON format. There's actually a BSON spec page on our site, and it's actually possible to use BSON as sort of a serialization, unserialization format, even without using the database, because we've got, for most languages, it's already implemented. So you could use it as an alternative to, say, Google protocol buffers, for example. So that's what we're storing things on disk in. You know, things are written to collections, and data in collections tends to be contiguous, so that table scans are fast when you want to do one. Is the general philosophy. There's not a clustered index feature currently in the product, right? So I have my main data file and then indexes, B-tree indexes. There's not like a clustered index relational feature currently. There may be one day, right? But we find that people get really good performance without it usually.
Are the indexes covered in the sense that you actually can consult the index rather than reading the actual data in the store?
Right, are the indexes covered? So the answer is partially. So we can use the indexes in a covered fashion, but the code is not smart enough yet to always do that. But it will do that in some cases today, and the roadmap is that we will do cover whenever we can long term.
Can you explain GridFS?
GridFS. So as I mentioned earlier, you can store binary data in a database, including very large objects like videos, or even larger. Conceptually, you could store a petabyte file in MongoDB. And the way we do that is we have the specification called GridFS, which is just the way to chunk large objects in the binary up. Basically, a way to chunk up a file into pieces that are say 1 megabyte each. So that's a spec, and all of the drivers support GridFS, and there are tools to read and write a file to and from the database using this GridFS format. So it's really just saying, let's all agree on a standard way to chunk up a giant file into these BSON objects and put them in the database. So putting videos in the database works fine. There's a site called Music Nation, which they store all of their videos in MongoDB. You know, it's about a terabyte of data. And it works for them pretty well.
I have a non-technical question. What is the roadmap for this MongoDB in terms of getting maturity level where somebody can really invest in terms of using this as a platform? Sort of like a Facebook type of, I mean, that's such a huge website, but any other platform. And what is the chances for ecosystem development, like other third-party vendors want to come in? And
all right, so I'll start with question two. Ecosystem, is there an opportunity for third parties to come in and do things? And the answer is absolutely. And from Tencent's perspective, we want as many companies as possible trying to do things with MongoDB. You know, if they're for-profit, that's great. We want to help because we think the larger the ecosystem, the better we will do too. So I gave a specific example. There's a company called MongoHQ, which is doing cloud-based MongoDB hosting. And you can go check it out later, mongohq.com. It has nothing to do with Tencent, but they're using Mongo to build this cloud computing database service. And so it's pretty neat. So and there's been a lot of interest in it, I know. So you know, more things like that. You know, I think there's an opportunity for, I was talking to someone earlier about building a content management system on top of MongoDB would be a really cool fit. Other administrative tools, other cloud-based services, I think more of that. Now, the first part of your question was sort of like, is it ready for prime time, especially the large sites?
Right, and what is the guarantee behind, money behind this, that it will sustain the next 5-10 years or whatever the roadmap you have?
Yeah, I mean, we're here for the long run, and I think there's also an open source community behind it. So, you know, all these solutions are new, so I guess there is some project risk to all of them. But, you know, MongoDB, I think, probably ties for most popular among all these NoSQL solutions with a couple of the other ones at least. So I think it's definitely the or a leading solution in the category. There's a lot of production usage. There's many thousands and thousands of downloads by developers for the product per month. So there's a lot happening right now with it. So I think it is a safe choice. You know, we're well funded, you know, for the next few years. I think, you know, it's not, you know, open source is not that capital intensive, so they're not going to be burning through, you know, tens of millions of dollars or anything like that. And the product works great. Like the core product in production, you know, it doesn't crash, it doesn't lose data, you know, knock on wood. You know, but we're not having stability issues or anything like that. I think you very much can use it in production today. I think on sharding is an alpha. You know, I think it will be in beta in 2 months. I think it will be in production 2 months later. I think, you know, it's most suitable right now. Like 20 node clusters, I think, are great right now. I mean, the architecture is such that you can do up to 1,000 node cluster. I think above 1,000 nodes, you need different designs. Same thing with Bigtable. Something like that would max out at that point. So that is the design goal, and there's theoretically no problem there, but we haven't tested it with a 1,000 node cluster yet, right? So if you need a 1,000 node cluster in 2 months, I say, you know, wait a little bit longer, but it will be running on 1,000 node clusters 12 months from now.
Yes. How were you able to develop the open source community to get it to this point?
How do we get to develop the open source community? You know, I don't think there's anything magic about it. It's just people like the product, so they decided they want to get involved. We encourage as much as possible. I encourage everyone in the room to get involved. You know, there's a lot of ways to get involved. You know, you can go code in C++ in the core database if you want. But if you don't want to do that, you know, you can write a driver. A lot of people have written data frameworks per language, which run on top of the drivers. That's a very popular thing to do. There are people translating the documentation in different languages. People doing meetups in other cities, which are just MongoDB community members. So there are people writing books on MongoDB right now. So I think you know, the community is good, but we want as much involvement by the community as all. The philosophy is to keep this very community oriented. You know, it's not just about building a company. We also want this to just be an extremely successful product in free versions.
Is there an embedded version? I mean, I know we kind of talked about thousands of servers. What about using it as a library or embedding it in some library or device or an application?
Yeah, embedding. So we haven't really done embedding yet. So all the usage today is really client-server. But theoretically, it would work well if that work was done, which wouldn't be hard, but somebody wanted to do it. Because the footprint of the server is pretty small, because it's written C++, and it would work well in an embedded environment.
Right.
But it's not really being used that way yet.
So it's something like, for example, a replacement for SQLite.
Yeah, I think in the future, things like that will be happening.
The Mongo daemon is like a few megabytes only, right?
Yeah.
It's tiny.
What's the migration path from LAMP in the old sense and LAMP in the new sense?
Yeah, what's the migration path? So we're not doing SQL, right? So if you're using Drupal or Joomla, you know, and it requires SQL, you know, you can't just plug in MongoDB. But if you're writing your own code, you can incrementally plug it in. We're seeing a lot of people do what I would kind of call organ transplants, right? Where if you've got a big complex system, what typically happens is you may have sort of 10 subsystems of data, which are somewhat distinct, like you don't join across them, right? But they're kind of partitioned. Even if they're in the same database, they're separate pieces of data, really. So what we've seen people do is they'll take a particular data subsystem, they'll port that to Mongo, they'll move the data over, and they'll change their code to talk to Mongo to manipulate that data. But they won't necessarily do their whole legacy systems at once. They'll pick the ones to the data, which is the best use case for Mongo, maybe the one where they have the highest current pain point, or the one where they're going to be writing a lot of new code and refactoring anyway, and they'll do that. So we are seeing a lot of people who have existing systems with a lot of the legacy code use Mongo, but they're using it kind of tactically. And then when people sort of use it soup to nuts, like Business Insider, often it's a new project.
Yes.
Yeah, I see the MongoDB used the chunk, has the length chunk. So I assume the exact matching of the key would be very fast. But if for the partial matching, the keys, would that be very slow?
So the question is about sharding and chunks and ranges. I'm not quite sure I understand the question.
For the keys, if you do the exact matching, probably the performance is very good. But for the partial matching, I want to have the wildcard matching star, tom, or star in the title. Would it be very slow if you have it?
Yeah, so if it's star tom, it's really going to have to hit every server. Now, if it were tom star, there may be a small number of chunks which are tom star in the shard key. It would then only hit the servers that use those chunks.
That's pretty much universal on all databases using a like statement.
Currently, whenever you scan through the feature index, feature index will really great for a small percent of the data. Let's say right now, if I'm issuing a query, that will hit like 80% of the tree just to you to the full scan instead of tree.
Yeah, that's a good question. So if you're retrieving a large percentage of a table or a collection, you know, using a tree actually slows you down. So the way our query optimizer works is it's actually going to, in parallel, try both versions of the query, and I think it'll find the table scan version that's faster and use it. I haven't tried that lately, but in general, it seems to behave reasonably. And you can give it a hint if you want to force that behavior, but in theory, it will do the right thing.
Is there a way to turn that error try out?
Yeah, is there a way to always specify hints? Well, you could just, if you consistently always give a hint, you'll be fine. I mean, you will get that. But there's no feature that says always require a hint. There's not a feature like that. So the intention is that you do use the query optimizer, and we find that it works pretty well.
Yeah.
So, but you know, it's the same issue you'd have with a relational database, although probably a little better. because the space of query plans we look at is smaller. And we do have this mechanism, this concurrent mechanism, which kind of trades off a little bit of performance for less pathological probability of behavior.
Are your indexes pluggable in the sense I could take Tokyo Cabinet and bring it into MongoDB?
Yeah, our storage engine is pluggable. There is an interface for doing alternate storage engines. We haven't yet integrated any other storage engines, though. There's an alternative storage engine for MongoDB right now. It's about half done that we wrote ourselves. But there is an interface, and that interface needs some more work. So we're moving in that direction, but it's not ready yet.
Specifically towards the indexes only, or just for the entire store?
For both.
Yes, back.
Is there any specific date for migrating from SpiderMonkey to V8? Currently, like MongoDB is using SpiderMonkey.
Right, SpiderMonkey versus V8. So these are JavaScript engines, and V8 is the one Google's written, which is actually faster. So we've the reason we're using SpiderMonkey is for cross-platform, because MongoDB run on almost all platforms, and SpiderMonkey is we're on most platforms too. The 64-bit version of V8 was just released, which most MongoDB installations are 64-bit. We've got an alpha implementation of V8 right now, working, but we haven't rolled it out yet. So I think in a month or two you'll see the V8 version. If you want to be an early tester, you could talk to us on IRC. We can make that happen too.
Last question of the night. Someone who didn't have a question yet. Anybody? Okay, it's yours.
Are there any object mappers, like not object relational mappers, obviously, but
yes.
Object document mappers or whatever they are?
Yeah, any kind of object style frameworks or persistent mappers from MongoDB. There are. It varies by language. In fact, I'd say for most languages, there is one. A good example is Mongo Mapper, which is a third-party community one that was written for Ruby, which seems to be really popular with MongoDB. But there are other ones for PHP, Python, etc.
All right, I want to thank everybody for coming. You'll be notified about the next meetup in your emails. Should come out either tonight or tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you.